Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Excellent. I want to begin this afternoon with a little story for you. An atheist was seated next to a little girl, and they were on a flight, and he turned to her and said, "You want to talk? Flights go quicker if you have conversation." The little girl, who just started to read her book, replied to a total stranger, "What do you want to talk about?" He says, "I don't know," said the atheist. "How about why there's no God or no heaven or hell or no life after death?" And he kind of smiled smugly. "Okay," she said, "that could be an interesting topic, but could I ask you one question? A horse, a cow, and a deer all eat the same stuff, grass. Yet a deer excretes little pellets, while a cow has patties, and a horse produces clumps. Why do you suppose that is?" asked the little girl. The atheist, visibly surprised by the little girl's intelligence, thinks about it and says, "I have no idea." To which the little girl replied, "Do you really feel qualified to discuss God, heaven and hell, or life after death when you don't know poop?" With all the Putin going around this week, I thought maybe that would work this week. A few around the other sessions. Anyway, this morning, I want to thank Pastor Lee for having me here this afternoon, sharing with you, because I get to travel to a lot of churches, visit a lot of pastors, and to get us all together sometime. The Bible says, "Behold, how good and pleasant it is when brethren dwell together in unity." And there's something about the anointing of God when we come seeking Him and put down all our titles and positions and the things that we do and say, "God, we're a child, we love You, we want to be a part of what You're doing." And God does some supernatural stuff in our midst. And it's always amazing to me how gracious God is to us, even though we've failed and made mistakes and haven't done it all right. When I was a young man, I graduated from the United States Army Chaplain School. One of the things I learned in the chaplaincy program is about rank, authority. You learned the difference between a lieutenant, a captain, a major, a general. And when you understand rank, one of the things you really begin to understand is that if I do all the right things in route to these positions, that you get promoted. And so if you do all the things that are necessary as a lieutenant, you get to be a captain. And if you get to do all the things as a captain, you become a major and a colonel. So with that in mind, I remember in 1991 getting called up for the Persian Gulf War. And I'd been stuck in a spot where you couldn't get promoted anymore because there's no opportunity for it because the positions were all stagnant. And I remember thinking to myself, if I only had an opportunity to go to war, we could break that lid and I'd get promoted. And as wonderful as that sounds, I fought back over those days, and the only way I would really get promoted when you go to war is because people die and slots become available. How selfish is it then to want to be promoted because someone else died so that you could have that position? And over the years, as I've looked at these, I want you to begin to understand this. It's God's call on your life that's put you where you are. And for some of you right now, you need to understand that you are a lieutenant, that you are a captain in God's plan. You are a major, a colonel, a general in God's house. And to serve the Lord with desire, with passion and authority and power has been given to us through Jesus Christ on the cross. He's not going to do any more for us. He's done everything He's going to do, but He's wanting us to know our identity. He's wanting us to know our authority. He's wanting us to learn to serve Him and to serve others so that God lifts us up. He puts us in place. The Bible says God sets one man down and another man up. When we learn to submit to God, we begin to understand how valuable our positions come, not because of us, but because God's people are the apple of His eye. He loves His church. He loves His people. And He says, because I love them so much, I'm going to find a Pastor Lee and put Pastor Lee over those people because those people are loved by Me and I want them to have a shepherd after My own heart. That God would raise up a Pastor Duane, that God would raise up a Pastor Clint, that God would raise you up in these times, listen, to be on the front lines of His authority structure so that you could make a difference in the heart and lives of the most precious thing that Jesus died for, and that was His people. Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. You matter to God. And because you matter to God, God says, listen, I need to send people your way that are going to help you. And he calls you and I out of the world, out of darkness, into his marvelous light. And he begins to take the foolish things of this world to confound the wise. And one day I found myself as a young minister laying on the floor. I felt the call of ministry. I wasn't even a minister yet. Laying on my floor one night as a new believer, and I said, God, I laid down, I didn't have a bed in my college dorm, and I just had the floor and a blanket, so I laid on the floor, and I said, in my immaturity, I said, God, how can I express my desire for you and my love for you, my passion for you? I don't know what to do. I just know now that you love me and I want to serve you. I was going to school to be a pilot in the Air Force, and that night I tried to keep my hands up as long as they could, and as they began to shake, I brought them down and fell asleep. But that night, God spoke to me in a dream, and he said, I'm calling you to be a minister. I had no idea. I was brought up a young Catholic. So to be a minister, I thought maybe I had to be a priest. And I thought, no, I don't want to do that, Lord. And I remember all those feelings of what does that mean? And I'm going to leave school, and I want to do this, and I want to do that. And it seems like every time I'd go to head in that direction, I would come up against opposition. As I've traveled to many of your churches over the last several years, one of the things that's, matter of fact, I got a call just a couple nights ago. One of the ministers that are here tonight said, listen, I'm going through something in my church and I don't think I can make the conference. And I'm like, no, you need to make the conference. You're a captain in God's army. You need to get there, get built up, get strengthened so that you don't make a decision right now that could take you out. And if you do that, even if God does take you out, it'll be because he's taking you out, not because you're taking yourself out. Somebody say amen to that. What I want you to understand tonight, as I begin to understand this idea of this call of ministry, is it's not so much about us as much as it is about God's heart for people, and he's looking for men, women, boys, and girls who will say yes to him so we can begin to equip the largest harvest of souls the planet has ever seen. The problem, of course, is if we don't love like we've never been hurt, then we bruise the sheep. We don't treat them the way they need to be treated. We don't love them the way they need to be loved. We don't teach the way we need to teach them because it's about us. We're living in a time that God's saying, I'm getting ready to bring in the largest harvest of souls, and we can't bruise all the fruit. You and I have to completely be in many ways dead to ourselves so that God can live his life through us, so that when we are about his business, the Bible says fruit will remain. If you have your Bibles with me, would you please turn to Mark chapter 4, verse 35. On the same day when evening had come, he said to them, let us cross over to the other side. Now when they had left the multitude, they took him along in the boat as he was. And the other little boats were also with him. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves beat it into the boat, so that it was already filling. But he was in the stern, asleep on a pillow. And they awoke him and said to him, Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? Then he arose, and he rebuked the wind, and said to the sea, Peace be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. But he said to them, Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? You know, the same faith that you start out with when you begin your journey is the same faith you need at the end. And one of the things I've learned over these last several months is that too many of God's captains, too many of his generals, too many of his lieutenants are going through battles and dealing with issues that they wonder, they're disappointed with God. God, why would you allow this pressure? Why would this thing happen? I remember in life and in ministry we have great celebrations. Over the years, we've celebrated some great victories. But I got to be honest, there's been a lot of defeats, or at least seemingly defeats. I remember when my wife broke her back twice and set us in a course where we tried to keep doing ministry, but we also had a heavy weight of dealing with that issue. I remember when my daughter Hannah, a month before she's ready to get married, calls off the wedding. And that seems maybe not a big deal, but what if you paid all the expenses already? I remember just a few weeks ago, I'll be honest with you, if I can be a little vulnerable, I Me and my wife, I said, honey, we need to go to a counselor. We need to talk a little bit about some stuff. And we went and sat down to this counselor. And the cool thing about this counselor was, here's what he said to me. Here's his counsel. And I'm so glad that we put on this conference, because I think I've saved thousands of dollars from counseling bills. Here's what he said. He said, I don't think you've done a good job over the years. He looked on our website before we got there. He says, I've seen your church. I've seen you've been here for over 25 years. He said, I see all the great things. You should be proud of all the things you do. Here's what he said. He says, but here's what I noticed. He says, I don't think you and your wife are doing a very good job of separating your relationship with each other from the ministry. I said, is there a separation? Too many times what's happened is everything from work comes home, and a lot of times from home goes to work, and we work together. Our kids have worked with us over the years, and so if I'm not careful, it all kind of fogs together, and sometimes I can have a great victory over here, but if I'm having trouble with a staff person over here, the problem becomes not so much at work, it becomes we're talking about that issue at home. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Listen to this. 1,500 pastors leave the ministry each month due to moral failure, spiritual burnout, or contention in their churches. 50% of pastors' marriages will end in divorce. 80% of pastors feel unqualified and discouraged in their role as pastor. 50% of pastors are so discouraged that they would leave the ministry if they could, but they don't think they can make a living any other way. By the way, these statistics came from Barna Fuller Seminary and Focus on the Family. 80% of seminary and Bible school graduates who enter the ministry will leave the ministry within the first 5 years. 70% of pastors constantly fight depression. Almost 40% polled said that they had an extramarital affair since the beginning of their ministry. 70% said the only time that they spend studying the Word is when they're preparing a sermon. Most statistics say that 60 to 80% of those who enter the ministry will not be in the ministry after 10 years. And only a fraction will stay in it as a lifetime career. Many pastors, I believe over 90%, start off with a true call, with the enthusiasm, the passion, the drive, the desire. But if we don't understand that there is an enemy who's on wanting to make an assault on you and your life and to pull you down and to hold you back and to keep you from the most precious commodity that God says we have, His people, then we're fighting each other. And we're wrestling and we're fighting and we're dealing with issues that really aren't issues that we should be fighting about. The idea is, of course, we've got to deal with us. To our own hearts, we have to be true. We've got to be honest with who we are. Make those great estimations, as the conference has said so far. Focus on the Family has reported that we in the United States lose a pastor a day because he seeks an immoral path instead of God's seeking intimacy where it must not be found. Focus on the Family stats state that 70% of pastors do not have close personal friends and no one in whom they can confide. I could go on and on and on and spend the afternoon giving you statistics, but I want to give you the hope. I want to give you the concept here that in this story there comes this huge storm upon the disciples, and Jesus recognizes that they're lacking faith. This story takes place on the Sea of Galilee, which is known for its sudden storms. Let me just take a commercial break to invite you to join Pastor Dwayne and Jeannie and I and others in 2 years to go to Israel again. There's probably nothing more exciting than to be on the Sea of Galilee going across and seeing one of these storms come up. It's just amazing. You read the scripture and it comes alive to you. Has anyone ever played the game of chess? I remember playing one time, and while I was moving the chess pieces around, a guy got me into, he said, checkmate. You know, when you say checkmate, it means he wins, it means you lose, it means it's over. And he said, checkmate, and I looked at the board, and you know, you're kind of staring, looking, is there any other possible, and then I noticed I had one more move. And this afternoon, while I'm joining with you, I'd like you to repeat this after me real quickly. Can you say, the king has one more move? It's said that there are storms that come affecting your families, your flesh, and your finances. And if you're pastor long enough, you'll know it's not one of them, it's all of them and more. But Paul was shipwrecked, then bitten by a snake. Repeat with me, but the king had one more move. You see, then he prayed for others and they were healed. Peter cut off the ear of the servant of the high priest, but the king had one more move. He healed the ear. A little boy gave 5 loaves and 2 fish, but the king had one more move and fed the 5,000. A man had a legion of demons. You get it? Would you repeat with me one more time? And the king had one more move. Lazarus had a bad day. He died. But the king had one more move. You understand this. Jesus went to the cross and it looked like it was over. But the king had one more move. Some of you are facing situations and trials and things that you don't want to talk about. You don't want anyone to know about. You're hiding things because you think if people find out, if they know, then it's really going to be over. But here's what I'm saying to you this morning or this afternoon. A network is not a denomination, but it requires that we build friendships so that we can talk about stuff and be real with each other, because I know people right now in denominations all over the country that would not dare call someone in their group and tell them what they're going through, because what they would do is they'd fire them immediately and then move them out. And that's a whole other set of issues. I'm not saying people don't need to be corrected or moved. What I'm saying to you is we've got to have trusted friendship relations in a network that cause us want to be together, not because we have to be together, so that we can deal with our stuff. Because if we're really going to be real, we've all got stuff. I need to be able to have a friend that I can call and say, listen, I'm stuck. I'm stuck. Me and my wife are not communicating. Rather than someone saying, I gotcha, that's your mistake. That's where you're, you know, bringing you down. They say, I understand. I've been there and I want to help you. The RLCI lead team is not a bunch of guys that are thinking that we're better than the rest of our teams. We're a group of guys, listen, who've gone through things that you probably don't even know or don't even imagine that we've gone through. But we're here at such a time as this because we want to be a blessing to you and help you fulfill your call, your purpose in life. We want you to be the generals of today's army. We want you to be the majors and the colonels. We want you, listen, to be what God called you to be. And we want to be able to hold your arms up and have you have real people in your life who've gone through real stuff, who've overcome it by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimonies. 3 quick things as we begin to talk about this challenge that when I was in the military and I thought about rank and going to the next level, the idea was a concept of I've got to do it all right. If I do everything the right way, then I'll get promoted. And I don't know about you, but if the ministry was like that, I guess I would have been out already. Because I don't do it all right. I have made mistakes along the way. All of a sudden, I began to realize that what the enemy's trying to do is he's going to take the force of the storm in verse 35 to 37. There are many forces to be reckoned with when it comes to storms. The lightning, the wind blowing, the flooding waters, all are forces that come with a storm. Spiritually, these are forces as well. Let's take a look for a moment at how these forces affect us, because there's been some debate after even Pastor Brady's message today about sabbaticals. And I talked to one pastor, he says, I don't like sabbaticals. And I understood it. I said, but you know what? You do a good deal of putting hedges in your life, and you regularly take care of certain things so that when storms of your life, you can handle them because you've been regularly taking care of them. I got to be honest, when you come up through the ranks and you think that the only way that you can really be a good minister is to work hard, which we heard about today, then I work harder and longer. But the challenge that I find is the harder and longer I work, the more I start working and operating into my own strength. The force of the storm may discourage you. When the winds of adversity begin to blow, discouragement certainly comes. I've often found myself discouraged in the midst of the storm. Disciples were certainly discouraged in thinking that Jesus was asleep and he didn't care about the storms. Likewise, as you are going through your storms, the devil will whisper that the Lord is nowhere to be found. You got to remember, the devil is a liar. God loves you. God wants you to win. God is on your side. And if you win, listen, if we can help a pastor not quit, not give up in these last days, then perhaps a marriage can be kept together. Perhaps a wayward child can come back home. Perhaps more than anything, that your community, your church, that would stay together because you stayed together. We need healthy men and women fulfilling God's purpose and God's call, but the enemy's doing everything he can. Listen, Pastor Duane said a long time ago, if one pastor gets discouraged, listen, his whole church can become discouraged. It's not that I can't be real. Had a friend of mine from the Assemblies of God. He said, man, I need some counseling in my life. But if I go to my leaders in my denomination, I know what they're going to do. They're going to judge me and criticize me and try to get me out of my ministry because they want to put somebody else in my spot. How terrible that we didn't have some real people that we could open up about and share how we're making it through this process. Because I've got to be honest, I don't care what denomination you're a part of or what network you're a part of, there's going to come a time, if you haven't been, that you're going to get discouraged. And you're going to need other men, other women, listen, who aren't looking to judge and criticize and find out where you're missing it, but they can look you in the eyes and say, listen, we're in this together. I want to help. What can we do? And sometimes that's a rebuke, let's be honest. God corrects those he loves. But this impending doom that somehow if I open up and share and become vulnerable, if that really gets out, no one will respect me. No, who cares what people are thinking? This is about keeping you in the battle till the finish. Number two, the force of the storm can drain you. The force of the storm can weigh heavy on you. It brings despair, or can bring. You will begin to think that the winds will never quit blowing. I remember 2008, our budget, we were moving along for 18 years in a row. Our budget had grown every single year. We were celebrating every year. I kept waiting for a bad board meeting the first 18 years about our budget, and every year it increased. But in 2008, my budget took about a $300,000 drop. And all of a sudden, you begin to think, well, that's awful. It was worse than awful. We tightened our belts. We did everything else. But I didn't really want people to know. I just lost because there wasn't much difference between me and the ministry. And I'm beginning to learn as I'm growing older that the ministry is going to keep going. As Pastor Duane said, when you put your finger in a glass of water, it doesn't take much to replace you when you pull your finger out of the water. But too often in the church, we've got to have the friends that say, listen, yeah, well, let me say it this way. I got to a point at one time where I thought, if one more person tells me they love me and then walk out of my life, I don't know if I'm going to make it. This is not my philosophy. I love people deeply. And so what happens when you love people and people just walk out of your life? People that said to me, Pastor Dave, you can bury me in the parking lot. I get nervous now when people say that. I'm going to be here. I'm going to be your Aaron. I'm going to help you. And here's what I know. It's not the straw that broke the camel's back. It's the last piece of straw that broke the camel's back. It wasn't the one time that someone said that to me. It's been the 15th time or the 30th time that someone said they love me and then completely did the opposite of what they said. And that's how I received it. And when you get to those places, don't you get, John, where you just say, I don't know how to keep going with this guy sometimes. How many times can you start up and the thing blows up and does well and then that whole group. I mean, I don't know about you guys, but in Bay City, we try to have small groups. We've had them for years. You try different kinds. You try different models. You read all the books. You go to different conferences. But the fact is, almost all my small groups, when they begin, they get together and they talk about what's wrong in their lives and what's wrong in the church, and they all end up leaving. How many of you know it's not good in our church to have small groups? Everybody tells me how wonderful they are. I'm thinking, you don't know Bay City. I'm just looking for some real people who want to do a real life, who want to serve a real God, and keep fighting the good fight of faith until Jesus comes. The force of the storm can defeat you. Listen, when you were thinking about giving up, like David, when he said, God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth be removed, though the mountains be carried in the midst of the sea, though the waters therefore roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with swelling. Psalms is full of moments where David went in and began to encourage himself. And I'm sharing with you, in a network, you not only have to encourage yourself, but listen, we've got to encourage each other. We've got to find people that we can be honest with and real with, who are not going to judge and criticize and bring us down, but rather say, listen, I've been through that. I understand that. We're going to get through that thing together. Somebody say amen. The other challenge that we have is the fears during the storm. Have you noticed when I've been through some battles lately, I'm experiencing things at 50 years old that I've never experienced before. I've never really had anxiety. I've never had feelings of sometimes doom or the bottom's going to fall out. I've never had those. So in the last year, I'm thinking, where is that coming from? You do understand that when you're facing things like that, that the enemy is doing everything he can to throw fiery darts at you to get you to flinch. There's a natural fear that comes with the storms of life. These disciples were afraid because they were not trusting. They forgot the Lord had said, let us pass over to the other side. He didn't say, let's get to the middle of the lake and drown. They simply did not trust the Lord when the great storm came. Cheryl and I have made a commitment that we've weathered a few storms over the years. We've run up against them. One of the things that I've had to guard over the last 25 years at our church is you would not believe how many people want to come and preach all the time at my church. I don't know. I guess we make it look easy. But everyone thinks they're a better preacher. So over the years, I've had to say, no, you're not ready yet. Well, what happens when you tell people no? They get mad. Who do you think you are? I'm called of God, but we were called to make sure that the pulpit was trusted and it was given to people, listen, who love God and were willing to lay down their lives for them, not all the amateurs that want to practice. Go to the nursing home if you want to practice. Go to the juvenile home. But listen, the church pulpit's not a place to let anybody and everybody just come up here and say whatever they want to say. But I've taken a lot of heat for that over the years. Because of unbelief, they were afraid of the potential dangers. When the Lord said, peace, be still, he was using a word that is used to rebuke the demons. It was as though he was saying to the storm, be muzzled. As one would muzzle an angry dog. This gives indication that the storm was no ordinary storm, but one sent by Satan. There is an all-out assault trying to attack you and to attack me to get us to quit what God told us to start. And the Bible says that no weapon formed against you will prosper. It doesn't mean he won't throw everything in the kitchen sink at you. It just means that you and I have to be grounded and rooted in our relationship with God so that although we are tempted as in all points as he was, listen, we can face that temptation, we can face those challenges because we've got a network of people who we can be real and honest with that will fight for us and will fight for them. Somebody say amen to that. Because of this unbelief, they were afraid of possible destruction. This indicates that when they said, Master, carest thou not that we perish? The Lord wants us to focus upon and trust him rather than focus upon the storm. I don't know about you. This has been a great week for me. This has been a great weekend for me. Cheryl and I were processing, and Pastor Lee put on our website, the RLI website. Are you checking the website out? The RLCI website, rlci.org, had a teaching on it a little while ago by Tom Lane. And Tom, he was executive pastor at Gateway, and he was talking about the importance of sabbaticals. And some of the guys here are on my board, and I'm on several boards, and they said, Pastor Dave, we think you need to take a sabbatical. I think Pastor John said that a couple years ago. And I thought, yeah, I'll get there. And, you know, this seems like the times is never right. So Cheryl and I are looking at this, and we've got a generation, a team in our church where we got people in leadership in their 20s and 30s and 40s and 50. And we thought, you know what? We're going to do it. We're going to take a break. We're going to trust God that the church belongs to him. And it's not by power, by might, but by his spirit, says the Lord. Now listen, you've got to be led by the Lord because if you're not led by the Lord, there can be trouble. But I'm just telling you, you and I have got to flesh that out and find that God, listen, God is interested in your success. He wants to bless you, but think of the idea of blessing is not so much that you won't go through storms, but every storm that comes, he will strengthen you and you become stronger. I thought for years ago, I want to help other pastors and help other churches. I didn't know God would keep putting me through the ringer. so that I would have some experience to be able to help some other pastors who've been through some of the same things that I've been through. Listen, I'm going to close with this. Having faith will help you trust. Romans 14, 23 says, whatever is not of faith is sin. Always remember, listen, would you repeat with me? The King has one more move. No matter what you're going through with your church board, no matter what you're going through with your finances, no matter what you're going through in your marriage, the King has one more move. God's going to use you in these times. Listen, but you can't flesh out, you can't freak out, you can't run away and hide under the covers. You've got to begin to face the things that you need to face. Listen, and find the friends that you need to come around you so that you can do what you need to do. When I was in the military, and we were in the Persian Gulf War in 1991, after so many days on the front line, they knew enough to take the guys off the front line and move them to the back of the line and move a new troops up to the beginning of front of the line. Some of you, listen, I've never taken a sabbatical in 25 years. I'm not even sure what it looks like. Pastor Brady said it took him 6 weeks just to unwind before he realized he was on sabbatical. We started a ministry, I'll close with this, we started a ministry a couple years ago called Leaders for Christ Training Center, where we're taking people out to California, and we're taking them out, listen, I didn't realize this at the time, but we're taking people out to California to jumpstart a rest in God. It's a week long where you get a jumpstart so that you can live with God's rest throughout the rest of the year. Some people need a longer sabbatical, some people need a shorter one, but here's what I know. You need to learn what it looks like so that you can model it to the rest of your team so that God can use it to refresh and renew you and strengthen you. Here's what I know, and I'm closing with this. No matter what you're facing in your finances, with your family, or with your church, there's a separation. There's you and there's the ministry, and God's saying, listen, you've got to be the best you can be. Let me fill you, let me strengthen you, let me get you where you need to be, and the same pressures are going to come, but you're going to be able to handle those pressures a lot better when you're healthy. I'm committed and our team's committed to being healthy so that we don't burn out, we don't rust out, we don't run out. Would you pray with me? Father, in the name of Jesus, we're here today believing that this conference is going to inspire, encourage, perhaps rebuke, but get us to a place, Lord, where we're not worrying about everything and everybody, that we're keeping our own households in order, that we're keeping our hearts in order, that we're doing what we need to do so that we can honor you, that we can honor your people, that you will use us to be those lieutenants and captains and majors and colonels and generals in your service. We love you. We're committed to you, Lord. Holy Spirit, come. And fill us and get us to do the things you want us to do so that we can be strong and run to the end. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Amen.
Almost every single day of my life, I'm working either in the local church or on the local church, and every day I become more passionate about the local church. I believe in God's awesome plan, the local church, and this is what we're doing about it. After 19 years of missionary work in Latin America, God put on my heart to create a church that could serve as a model of an excellent, fun, relevant church for all Latin America. June 2004, we started Vida International in Saltillo, Mexico. In the last 10 years, Vida has grown in both size and influence. With a church model that is primarily focused on the unchurched, for approximately 60% of the people that attend in our different campuses, this is their first experience in a Christian church, experimenting an authentic relationship with their Heavenly Father. To model our church planting strategy, Vida Saltillo planted Vida Monterrey in February 2014. A one-year rollout strategy helped the church to begin with a core of 200 people committed to the vision. Our first year of setup, tear down, 8-hour Sundays only fueled the vision for people to own their own local church. In 1 year, the 200 people core has now doubled in size to over 400, and this month, March 2015, we move into our own lease building. You know, if we really believe that Jesus, through the local church, is the hope of the world, there can never be enough good churches. We need to train more people. We need to send more people. And we need to build more churches. Hey, speaking of training and planting churches, this was 2 months ago in Cuba. Check it out. Hey, everyone. Here in Havana, Cuba. It's January 2015. We're in the middle of a pastor's conference. We've got hundreds of pastors. We're just finishing up a session. There in the main auditorium, we've got pastors, about 150 on the roof in different sections of the building. And this year is such an exciting time for Cuba because we've all heard the news, what's going on. And the truth is, these men and women that you're looking at right now, everyone are pastors. They pastor 2 to 3 to 5 to 10 churches. Some of them are church denominational leaders. In other words, they pastor 100, 200, 300, 500 churches. And there's some incredible times that are starting to come to Cuba. Right now, we're developing a plan to plant all kinds of churches around the island. And these people here are the heroes of the faith in this nation. And we're so grateful, everybody, that's part of what's happened for the last 22 years of our ministry here in Cuba. We love you. This is just a part of what's going on. All right, it's good to be here with you today. Why don't you stand up a second? Just stand up, shake it off. It's after lunch session, getting towards the afternoon, a lot of you guys take your 2 o'clock nap like the Mexicans do, and you missed it. Anybody want to know the scores? Michigan State won by 6 or 8 or something like that, so... Clint would be glad to know Kansas won. You can sit down now. I want to continue with what I was talking about here in Cuba. And I'm going to take about 20 minutes. Matter of fact, in about 20 minutes, whoever plays the piano or whatever, come on up. And we want to finish things with some prayer. But I want to continue on with that video. That day, which was 2 months ago, actually there was airplanes full of people coming into Cuba. You know the story. President Obama wants to lift the embargo. People start to come in. And so we had a pastor's conference. We had about 550 to 600 pastors there. About 250 of them are friends of mine. We've worked for 23 years on the island of Cuba. And so that evening, I wanted to do a special session. The next day, I was leaving to head back to Mexico. So we got the principal pastors together with denominational leaders about 9 o'clock at night, took them up on the third story on the roof of a church, and just looked out over the city Havana. And I want to share with them, talk to them about a little bit about the times that were coming, because they all had been praying for the last 56 years that God would bring change to their country. And now it was starting to come. So I want to just have a little session with them. And I want to talk to you about that session because I want to challenge you with the same thing I challenged them about. And the title of my little session with these 250 pastors and denominational leaders was Future Challenges, Temptations, and Dangers to Come. So we took about 2 hours, and I started to talk about the different things that would happen in Cuba. And this wasn't prophetic. It was just, look, a lot of countries that have been closed, or communist countries, have broke open. And when they break open, there's just a sequence of things that always happen. It's not always the same timing, but these are the things that are going to happen. Cuba has 3 monetary systems. The first thing that would happen is, and the government has already started to do this, was to hone it down to 1 monetary system. When that happens, hyperinflation will start, and there'll be all kinds of control situations and inflation and prices, and people will begin to scatter to figure out how can they survive, and then how can they take advantage of the times. But there's a special thing that happens with the churches. So I had 250 leaders. We're talking about what their future holds as church leaders and pastors.
And this was my message to them. I said, pastors, this is what's going to happen. I don't know the exact timing, but this is what's going to happen. Number one, you've got 360 million people 90 miles from here. I was talking about the United States. And it's a very, very prosperous country. And it's a developed country. So one of the first things that's going to happen is you're going to have a flood of people come into your country, and they're going to start to scoop up all the denominations that are in this country. The denominations will come back, and they're going to start to scoop up their churches again, because for 56 years, Cuba was considered closed. So the Baptists, the Methodists, the Presbyterian, you name it, and there's 60-some different denominations. Basically, everything funneled down into one style church. All the churches were the same. And there was revival and harvest of souls, incredible, incredible harvest of souls during the Castro regime. I said, so the first thing that's going to happen is denominations are going to come back in because according to them, Cuba is open again, and so they're going to come back and they're going to scoop up their churches. And what that means for you is some of your best friends, which is the church down the street, who you've been to war with, been a leader alongside because of persecution against the church. He was a guy sitting next to you when the state police came in and laid a gun on the table and said, if you don't do this, we're going to shoot you in the head. And he was right there by your side. He's your best friend. Well, this is what's going to happen. The denominations are going to come in. They're all going to scoop their churches up, and the walls will start to rise up between the churches. When I said that, I had these guys' attention, 250 pastors that represented probably about 5,000 churches on the island, and they're starting to shake their head. They're saying, no, that's not going to happen. That's my best buddy down the road. He's a Baptist. It's a Baptist down the road. He's my best buddy. We've been to war together. I said, you don't even realize the millions and millions of dollars that will flood into this country. And a lot of it will be dollars that come in on the backs of denominations that your buddy down the road scraped together money for 15 years to put a drum set and a guitar in his church. Now they're going to come in and say, hey, if you'll just put yourself under our covering again, we're going to come in with everything you need. It's going to happen. So I had their attention. They started squirming in their seats. I said, you've prayed for this for 56 years. I said, the next thing, and there'll be all kinds of other ministries that come in. The next thing that'll happen is the church, you all, will no longer be the go-to. Because you've lived in a country for 56 years where the system has stripped people from hope. And people need hope, so people would go to church. Because you had the product that was hope. God is hope, and people would flood into your churches. That will change. Said, not only will that happen, but you won't be the go-to anymore, but now you're going to start to compete with malls, with amusement parks, with sports, with television, with movie theaters. There's no movie theaters in Cuba, but they're all going to flood in. There's sports. There's no amusement parks. There's just nothing. I said, you're no longer going to be the go-to. In other words, you no longer have a corner on the market. Everybody needs hope, and you've got it. So everybody is going to get saved. And that's the way it was in Cuba. A lot of times we wouldn't talk about this because for many years we were doing a lot of underground work because it was illegal what we were doing. And so even in a lot of y'all's churches, you know, Res Life here, Lee's Church, Support Cuba, and a lot of times we wouldn't talk about a lot of things that were happening, but there's thousands and thousands and thousands of people getting saved because the church would give hope. I said, pastors, leaders, it's a new day. You're going to have to get good. You're going to have to be excellent. You're going to have content, quality. You're going to have to be relevant. These guys sat there looking at me like a calf looking at a new fence post. Because the majority of them were, you know, unless you were 60 or older, you would have no point of reference. This was your life. You've lived on that closed island for 50, 60, 30, 20 years, and you have no point of reference. I said, but the biggest thing that's going to happen is the hearts of many people. There will be a window of huge harvest, but what will happen soon is the hearts of many people will begin to grow cold towards God, because another God is on his way, and that God comes in billions. It's the God that dominates most people. That's the God of money. I said, in men and women's hearts will grow cold, because people become self-sufficient. We don't need God anymore because we can take care of ourselves. Look at Europe. Europe is so dark. Why? Because of the affluence, and everybody says, why do we need God? We can take care of ourselves. I said, gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen, because there's a lot of lady pastors in Cuba. I said, ladies and gentlemen, this is what's coming. So by then, everybody was just kind of squirming in their seats, and then we had a powerful, powerful time. Because I said, look, I said, I want to ask you a question. And this is the question I'm going to ask us before we leave. To be able to lead the way for God, we have got to be not only called, but we have got to have passion to lead. That's the time. The earth needs leadership. We need leaders. We need pastors and leaders that are passionate about leading. I said, where are you on the passion scale? So I had these pastors, and they're starting to get fired up. I'm saying, times are coming, and this is your day. 56 years, and you've been just riding the wave. There's been awesome things happening. People coming into your church by the hundreds and the thousands, but things are going to change, and now it's time to lead. Where are you on the passion level? And so I said, look, I said, I'm gonna hone this down to three things, and it's probably a little more complicated than three things, but I've been accused of oversimplifying before, and so I won't be afraid of being accused of that again. I said, look, passion for leading, I'm going to bring it down to three things, and this will keep you on the edge to be able to lead Cuba into a new day. And I just basically talked to him about three things. I said, look, first thing I want to talk to you about is growing. Grow personally. If you grow personally, you will always be relevant. You'll never lag behind. Grow personally, and I'll talk to you about that in a little bit. Second thing I talked to him about, I said, be more about the future than the past. I'm going to say that again. Be more about the future than the past. I'm going to say that again. Be more about the future than the past. And the third thing I talked to him about, my third point was, ride with the posse. Not alone. Ride with the posse and not alone. And as I sat there and we talked back and forth and talked about personal growth, and we talked about the future, and we talked about teamwork and riding with a posse and doing things together, and it was an awesome and a powerful time. And basically what I felt like God was doing was taking these Cuban pastors and leaders to a place of understanding now was their day. They've been riding the wave of just an awesome thing that God was doing beneath the blanket of communism, but now that thing's going to be torn off of there, and it was time to lead. And I prayed with them, and that night basically I got done about 10, 11 o'clock, went downstairs, drank some Cuban coffee, and about 1 o'clock headed down to my little, I stay at this, I stay right at the church, kind of in this little closet, and it's small, got a little teeny bathroom in there, just kind of tuck in there and sleep. I was going to sleep for a couple hours and head off the next day. That's usually the way our Cuba trips are. We blow in, blow up, blow out, get out of there fast, and that's the way it was. Matter of fact, that reminds me of a trip. I have a Lee story, a Lee Cummings story. We've worked in Cuba for 23 years, and in 1999, The Cuban government gave the evangelical church permission to do outdoor meetings, open air meetings. So I invited Pastor Lee. I said, come on down. We're going to do these open meetings all across the island. It's going to be awesome. There's going to be thousands, hundreds of thousands. We were in the Plaza de Revolucion. What do you call that? The main plaza where Castro does his, well, used to. He's getting pretty old now. Used to do his discursos. How do you say that? His big speeches. And so we had about 100,000 people there. So anyways, the story is Lee flies down to Mexico. We're in Guadalajara, Mexico. That night we had a graduation for a Bible school. So we did the graduation, pulled into this Bible school, in our Bible school, left my Suburban on the street, went in and did the graduation, walked out about 10, 11 o'clock at night, and I turned to find my Suburban. Suburban wasn't there. I thought, I must park down another street. So we walked down the street, and I started looking for my Suburban. Then I thought one of my students was playing a trick on me. So I thought, somebody must have moved my car. Make a long story short, our vehicle got stolen. Walked out there, it was gone. So I said, Lee, we got to go down to the police station. So we go down to the police station, and we spend almost all night long there. Our flight was about 5 o'clock in the morning. We got down about 3 o'clock in the morning, and vehicle was gone. We did all the police reports, went back, packed our suitcases, ran to the airport, jumped on the airplane, flew to Cuba, came into Havana, and rented a vehicle. We're taking off with our vehicle to go all the way across the island, about 750 miles. And the vehicle, two vehicles we went through before we got a vehicle that actually worked. We had, one of them was a diesel vehicle. Remember, it was pouring diesel out the tank. And so we thought, hey, this is going to blow up on us. We got to have another vehicle. So then there was another one, this and that. Finally got that done. Drove across the island the rest of the day and through the night. So now we had been awake two nights, and we're on our third day. So we get all the way, and I'm jaw jacked up. It's like, man, we got a crusade. First time in Cuba since the revolution. And we're in two nights with no sleep. We're in our third day with no sleep. And well, actually, on our way, we're driving, and Lee's like, John, I have got to eat something. We haven't eaten. Do you realize we haven't eaten in 2 days? I said, we haven't eaten? No, we haven't eaten. So I said, well, we'll stop and get something. Well, in Cuba, you just don't stop at Mickey D's. There's one road through the country, and it's like a tar mat for airport, and then it weaves down, down, and down. By the time you get to far end of the island, it's dirt. It's not like highways, and there's not Mickey D's on the corner. So there's no restaurants, there's no nothing, but there was a gas station. So we found in this gas station this little communion bread. It was unleavened communion bread. So I think it was some grape juice. I don't remember what it was. I said, come on, Lee. I said, we'll take communion together, or some apple juice or what it was. So we ate. So we're on our third day with no sleep for, I don't know, 72 hours. And we're getting ready. I'm pumped. I'm like, I've been working in this country forever. And we are ready. Finally, if you ever watch a story called, about the Navy SEALs. The Navy SEALs, when they put them underwater, or they put them through major, major stress, when they're just about to pass out, the Navy SEALs call it seeing the wizard. They see the wizard. The wizard, I don't know what the wizard is. And this isn't doctrinal or anything like that. This is just the wizard. Whatever Navy SEALs is the wizard. So we had been talking about this thing, these Navy SEALs, and pretty soon after the third day, Lee's like, John, I'm seeing the wizard. I'm seeing the wizard. I got to sleep. Can we sleep somewhere? I said, why? What's the deal? We haven't slept. Oh, man, I forgot about that. All right, we'll find a place to sleep. So we slept for a while, and we traveled the rest of the island. But that's my Lee story. He said, 2 days, no food except this communion bread, and 3 days, no sleep. I said, that's the Varican training camp. Cuba. So anyways, I drank my Cuban coffee after time with the pastors, went into this room, laid down to sleep, and God spoke to me. And I was so surprised because I was just, it was like, okay, I got to get to sleep. I got 3 hours, I'm going to be up at 4 o'clock, got to roll. And I don't need a sabbatical. I just thought of that. I'm just teasing Dave. Lily informed me, said, when you would take a sabbatical, I said, I did. I've been in ministry for 30 years. I said, I did about 4 years ago, 3 days. 2.5, and I cut it. I said, that's it. I got the roll. We're all different. Hey, don't judge me. So God spoke to me. He said, and I wrote down a question. He said this. He said, so what's the difference between Cuba and the rest of the world, John? You know, when God asks you a question, he's going to give you the answer. So I'm sitting there thinking, I'm thinking, well, Cuba. And this is what he said. It's only a matter of timing. He just spoke to my heart. It wasn't audible or anything like that. It just came into my mind. So what's the difference between Cuba and the rest of the world? And I thought, I don't know. He said, it's just a matter of timing. Cuba's going through their time, but most of the world has already been through it. And most of the world, it's not just boom and it's open. Most of the world has just been a process, but it's all the same. Just what you spoke to the Cuban leaders, the rest of the world is basically living in that same world. And you need to share that with the rest of the leaders. When he said that, I immediately wrote down what we had been talking about. And I decided that's what I'd share with you. Because the truth of the matter is that our leadership, our future depends on our passion scale. Are we passionate about leading? Are we passionate about what we're doing? How is your passion scale? Do you want to lead people and pastor people more than anything else in the world? Because if the answer is anything but yes, then we might need a little injection of passion from God. I know it's 4:13 in the afternoon, but you can get excited 4:30 in the afternoon or 4:13. What's your passion scale for leadership right now? I wasn't just blowing smoke what I talked about in the video. It's like every day I become more passionate about the church. I believe the church is the hope of the world. And every single day I wake up and I think we've got to do more, we've got to sow more, we've got to build more, we've got to train more. So if we're gonna lead our generation in this crazy new world that we live in, I just want to remind you of the three things I told the Cuban pastors. Just three things. Three things. And this is, you can take this with you. If you're on overload because this is the last session and everybody has been, I checked out the amount of scriptures that everybody used. Pastor Lee used 10. Pastor Dwayne used 24. Clint had 13, and I was following Pastor Dave on his thing. He had about, I don't know how many, probably about 15. So, and I didn't have any. So last night, Lee said, you don't have any? You better find some and put them in there. So I have two. Point number one to the Cuban pastors, point number one to you, grow personally. Grow every single day. You've got to have in your daily schedule time to grow. Time to grow. 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 Grow in your call. Grow in the word. Grow as a man or a woman. Grow as a father or mother. Grow in general knowledge. Grow in business. Grow in technology. Man, don't use the excuse, well, I'm 60 and so I don't know how to use those gadgets. One of my favorite things to do is to, when I go into an airport, I travel a lot, I go into an airport, I usually go to, I can get into to a business club and I work and do my stuff. But when I have to go down to the gate, I go down to my gate and the first thing I do is I scope out everybody and I try to watch people use the technology. And I'm trying to find the oldest person that knows what they're doing. And I love to see, there's this woman that sketched in my mind. She could hardly walk. She looks like she was about 150 years old. And she just kind of scooting down the airport and this and that. She sat down pretty soon. She pulls out her thing, pulls out like 50 gadgets. She plugs one in. She's scrolling through another and this and that. I said, you are cool. You are cool. I told her, I said, you're my hero. Grow. Grow. Okay, Cuba's back in the 50s, and all of a sudden they're going to be ushered into the 2000, 20, but we're in the same boat. If we don't grow every single day, we're going to be antiquated. We need to grow. That's what I love about Pastor Dwayne and Jeannie. I love their passion for books. If I read as many books as he reads, I would be totally confused. I feel like I go into his office, he's got books. I think, man, if I read all that, my mind would blow up. I'd be sitting there reading and just, they'd have to put on my grave. It's like he read too many books and just blew up. They came over to our house about, we were down in Mexico about, oh, I don't know what it was, probably about 2 years ago. And, because, you know, Pastor Dwayne's regimented, you know, and he's got traveling with all the books. I came downstairs in the morning, I was getting coffee, and I hear all this noise down in the basement. It's like, what in the world's Pastor Dwayne and Jeannie doing down there? I was very interested, I'm hearing this thing. I got an elliptical machine down there, and that thing's going, like, what are you doing? So I kind of go to the door. Well, Dwayne's on the machine. Jeannie's reading a book and reading a hymn out loud. So I thought they were having a conversation and all this. They're reading, and it's like, Jeannie, I'll get down the machine. You got to read to me. So Jeannie's reading and this and that. And get in the car. We get in the car. We're going somewhere. He's in the front. She's like, Jeannie, keep reading me that book there. I think they're the coolest ever because they love to grow. You got to grow. You got to grow. There's not time to get into it, but there's three things you need to grow. You need people, you need resources, you need experience. Second thing I want to talk about is don't live in the past. Live in the future. Be about the future, not the past. Be about the future. Today is a new day. God's doing a new thing. If you tried something that didn't work out in the past, leave it there. Just, it's part of the past. Don't worry about it. Too many people just fret so much about what's going on. Well, you don't know what I've been through. Well, I understand I've been through a few things. I thought he was going to pull me off the stage. I see somebody sneaking up behind me. Take it easy, Brandon. Celebrate the past. But go towards the future. God's doing a new thing. Today, you were here for 3 days for this conference. In the next 5 minutes, you can say, boom, my past is the past. I am going forward with God. He's got something new and good for me. This is what the Bible says. Hold on. Don't clap. Let me get my Bible in here. Isaiah 43:19 says this. It says, forget about what's happened. All right, we got it up there. I sent it in late, so I didn't know if it was going to make it. Not like getting a verse to back up what you got to say, right? Forget about what's going to happen. Don't keep going over old history. I'm going to say it again. Don't keep going over old history. Let it go. Be alert. Be present today. I'm about to do something brand new. I'm bursting out, God says. Don't you see it? Can you see it? God wants to do a new thing with you. Don't keep going over old history. I skipped over the other verse I had. I just found, and I can't go back because I'm over my time anyway, so we'll just leave it at that. I had one verse. You shouldn't have applauded me for that. Okay, and then the third thing I talked to Cuban pastors about was ride with the posse. Ride with the posse. Ride with the posse. I like the Garganos here. Road to Life? Road to Life Church. How many people you got here? 31. Give them a pause. Let's give them a hand. 31 people. That's called riding with the posse. I don't have a verse for that. The only person I could quote was Gus from Lonesome Dove, so I'm just going to leave it at that. And if you don't know what Lonesome Dove is, forget about it, and it probably won't be real good. So, ride with the posse. Of course, there's the whole Bible talks about that. Jesus got his 12 together. Everything talks about teamwork. You don't need to be told it once again. I'd encourage every single one of us here. Next year, we'll do our conference, our winter conference, and man, bring your church. Bring your church. That is smart leadership. Bring them all. Bring them to the big house. All right, guys, this is what we're going towards. Ride with a posse. Don't do it alone. You do it alone, you'll get discouraged. You'll feel like you can't do it. But you get a bunch of you together, and everybody gets each other jacked up. That's New Testament. That's a freaking version. Bible says encourage one another. Get each other jacked up. We can do it. We can do it. Yeah, we can do it. And then you build the church. And you impact your generation. If you feel like that you've just kind of got stagnant in your passion level, because we live in a new day, but you feel like your passion level is just kind of I'll take 2 minutes to pray for you. 2 minutes. Doesn't take God long to just boom, okay, that's in the past. It's a new day. It's a new day. He's doing a new thing. So I'm going to ask you to bow your head, please. And if you feel like you've just gotten a little stagnant, and today's the day you can make a decision for a breakthrough. You've listened to all kinds of different teachings and preaching, and you're thinking, man, God, when are you going to do it? Maybe you just waited for the last minute. You're about to walk out the door. You got to come back 6:30 for the concert. But you're about to walk out the door of this time that we minister together as leaders. And you were thinking, that was it. It didn't happen. Well, I'd venture to say that he's going to do it yet. If you feel like your life has gotten a little stagnant and you're just, the passion level's not there, and you think, okay, personal growth, yeah, and I want to, you know, yeah, I want to look at the future, not the past. I want to ride with a posse. I want to get a huge group together. I want to run with a team and this and that. But I just feel like I've just gotten stagnant. I'm not there. Excuse me. I want to pray for you, real quick. I'm just going to ask you to stand up where you're at. Just stand up. That you? God's going to do something for you right now. He'll do it. He will do it. Father, every single man and woman that's on their feet right now have waited this whole conference for you to reach into their heart by your Spirit, do a profound work in their life, reordering priorities. Maybe taking your hand and removing rubble, crazy thoughts, injecting into their life a new passion. Your word says that you're doing a new thing. And I believe today, even though that was written thousands of years ago, I believe today you're doing a new thing. And I declare that new thing is going to happen in the hearts of every man and woman that's on their feet right now. A new thing. A new thought. Maybe just one thought from you, Father, that would clear up all the clutter. New idea. New level of your grace. To be able to forgive and forget and lay it behind. your divine energy on the inside of us causes us to run and not be weary. Father, I ask that you would give strength to the weary. I ask that you would give that you'd give power to all of us in this place to lead with wisdom, with knowledge, and with passion. I declare passion over you, encouragement over you, excitement, new excitement in your life, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. And Father, I thank you that right now there is a new day, a new time, a new season established in our lives. I want you to do something with me. Those that are on their feet, just say with me, thank you, Father, for a new day. Thank you for a new day. Thank you for a new day. I'm going to ask everybody to stand up. With those that are standing, just raise your hands. And Father, we thank you for a new day. We thank you, Father, that the past is gone. And Father, we celebrate the great things that you've done. But today's a new day. You need new leaders. You need innovative, creative, growing leaders. And Father, we want to be those leaders for you. Father, thank you for that. Thank you for your goodness. Father, thank you that today we've got new eyes to see, new ears to hear. Our vision is clear, and we can run strong in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Amen.